So and if we are using modern neural nets, we have the choice of the network structures and dropouts, etc., and even step size in optimization. So let's say just given the training data D and the particular choice of M, that will return us an F hat indexed by this fitting procedure. And our goal is to find the best M, either it's a model or it's just a tuning parameter setting that the resulting F hat sub M has smallest or as small as possible risks among the choices. And here comes the cross-validation, because when we do risk minimization and model selection, we want like V-fold cross-validation is perhaps one of the most widely used method. So what we do is we split the data into folds, and for every fold, we fit the model estimate for all candidates using all the data except that fold, and then we evaluate the empirical risk of the fitted model on that fold, and then we circulate this overall fold and average them up to form the final cross-validation estimate of the risk for each candidate model. And then what we do is we take the minimum of all these cross-validated risk estimates. So the popular choice of number of folds are 5 and 10 and n. When it's n, it's the leave one out cross-validation. So here is a very simple example, perhaps the simplest example illustrating the failure of cross-validation. So we have a very simple model. Y is f plus epsilon, and f is not any function of x. It's just a constant. Okay, so we have two theories about the model. The first model says that, okay, f is zero. So it's a very simple model and the strongest assumption. And the second candidate model says that, okay, I don't know much about f. F is just some real value. So one of these has to be true. Let's say the truth is the simpler one. F is indeed a constant zero. And then we want to use a twofold cross-validation to see which model has the smaller empirical risk. So then simple algebra implies that the cross-validated choice of the model is the true model if and only if we have this inequality where the epsilon bar, the epsilon one bar is the sample average of epsilon in the first fold, and epsilon two bar is the sample average, because here epsilon equals y because there's no f, f is zero. So only when this quadratic form inequality holds, we would choose the first model. So here actually you can see that the two square terms represent the signal, and actually the cross term represents the noise. So, and it's pretty well known that V-fold cross-validation is inconsistent unless you use most, the majority of the sample points for validation. And this can never happen in V-fold cross-validation. So here we would like, so obviously even in cross-validated risk estimate, there are like there are decompositions like the signal and the noise. So we would like to understand the uncertainty in the cross-validation risk estimates. So how do we construct, the key question is how do we find or construct error bars associated with the cross-validated risks? And before doing this, we have to ask ourselves, what does the cross-validated risk estimate, right? What is the target we should be aiming at? So one perspective is I think the original motivation of cross-validation is that by using an independent validation set, we're unbiasedly estimating the risk of the fitted model using all but one fold, right? So that it's fairly reasonable to say that the cross-validation risk targets the average of the true risks of all leave one fold out model estimates. Okay, and this quantity is itself a random quantity because it depends on the leave one fold out fitted models. So more ideally, we would like to take out even this layer of randomness to hope that the cross-validation risk really estimates the grand average of everything, even if we average over the randomness in our leaf one fold out model estimate. So it's just putting another layer of expectation outside. And this is a non-random quantity, and which would be ideal if we can make inference about this quantity. And so the short message is that it's more cleaner, like technically easier to treat for the random target, and with stronger conditions and more lengthy bookkeeping, we would also be able to extend part of the result to the non-random quantity. So in this talk, we will focus on the random target. Okay, so the main technical ingredient for understanding like the error bar in cross-validation, and also in the quality of cross-validated risk estimate, is stability. So what do we mean by stability? Here, let D be the data set with IID entries. And D sub I is the data set, perturb the data set by replacing the ith entry of it by an IID copy, xi prime and yi prime. And then for any function h acting on this data set, so it returns a scalar, right? So we use nabla ih as an operator denoting the difference of h applied to d and d sub I. Okay, so if this difference is small, that means at least for this function h, right, it's stable. That means if I just perturb one sample point in my data set, the difference is small. So what we want to be stable is actually the loss function. So here, if I apply nabla I to my loss function, so here the loss function, remember that the y0 and x0 is the future. This point we don't perturb. So the only thing we can perturb is the training data that we use to obtain our model fit. So that means if we perturb our model fit by swapping one observation with an IID copy, then the resulting change in the predicted value or the loss is very small. And when this difference is of order small o one, then for leave one out cross validation, we know that the CV risk estimate is a consistent estimate to the population version that we want. Okay, but only consistency is not enough to get error bar. To get error bar, we need some sort of CLT. So this progress was made 3 years ago by different groups of people. So I will mainly focus on the work. Sorry, I shouldn't move my cursor like that. Okay, by Austin and Joe in 2020. So their result is that if the stability, the perturb one stability of the loss function is of order small o one over square root n, but also the second order stability. It's like one nabla is taking the first order difference, and the nabla j and the nabla I is that you take second order difference. You take a difference in difference. So if this difference in difference of the loss function after you perturb two points, then it's of smaller order than 1/n, then what we can say is that the cross-validated risk converges to the target, either the random target or the fixed target, at rate 1/√n and with asymptotic normality. Okay, so I think this is a groundbreaking result, and I tried to use it, and I started thinking if we can actually use this for model selection. Then I got stuck immediately, right? So we're interested in finding the minimum of the true risk over all candidates. So we needed to study the joint distribution of all cross-validated risks, not just one of them at a time. So when the capital M, which is my number of candidate models, if this M is small, then fine, I have multivariate joint normality. Maybe I can construct a confidence set of the model from there. But typically, especially in modern machine learning, the cardinality of M is large. Okay, so when M is large, but we still want some asymptotic normality or Gaussian comparison, we need to extend the CLT to high dimension. So this reminds me of how people have extended CLT from low dimension to a higher dimension Gaussian comparison for independent high dimensional vectors. So this is very well known, the celebrated CCK result, and later developed by many other researchers. So the goal, the first part of our work here is to extend, to combine the high dimensional Gaussian comparison and low dimensional CLT for cross validation. So here, what we want, like a technical ingredient here is sub-Weibull tail, because for high dimensional Gaussian comparison, if you read the CCK proof, a key step in the proof is that you need to simultaneously control the tail probability of many, many small terms. So essentially, a single moment condition on each individual small term is not enough, because Markov's inequality, then you need to use Bonferroni and the bound blows up. So you need some sort of exponential tail decay for the small terms so that you pay a small logarithm price to control all of them at the same time. So this is where sub-Weibull stability comes in. So for a random variable Xi, we say Xi is K alpha sub-Weibull if all of its any LQ norm scales, like controls by K and times a small polynomial, not necessarily small, but any polynomial in Q. Okay, so the key part is that it scales with K and a polynomial. And equivalently, so the tail probability is exponential in a polynomial of the tail, okay? So it covers sub-Gaussian and sub-exponential as special cases. And here we don't really care about how large or how small alpha is, and we really care about the K, because here the capital K reflects the scaling of this random variable. So we really just call it K sub-Weibull, meaning that it cannot be too much bigger than K. If it's much bigger than K, then that chance happens with exponentially small probability. Okay, so here comes our extension. So I'll just pretty much skip all the technical details and state the result. So if the first order stability of the loss function is sub-Weibull smaller than, with the scaling smaller than 1/√n, and the second order stability of the loss function is sub-Y ball with scaling much smaller than n to the 3/2. So this is a pretty strong condition, and we'll come back to it later. And this is stronger than what was required for the low dimensional CRT in earlier work. So, and also the original loss function is one sub-Y ball, so that like they behave like constant, right? Like a order one random variable and with variance non-degenerating bounded away from zero. Then what we can say is that, so the maximum, so this is like an L infinity type of Gaussian comparison. So the maximum of my estimation error, so which is the difference between my cross-validation estimate and the random target, the average of true risks cross the folds, right? Multiplied by square root n, and the maximum of that vector has this nearly the same distribution as the maximum of a corresponding centered Gaussian vector y. Okay, and here we can explicitly write out the covariance matrix of the Gaussian corresponding Gaussian vector y. So what this means is that we are ready to construct confidence, simultaneous confidence bands for this target R2.m, that is the average risk of fitted models averaged across the leave one fold out rotation. So here is our plug-in simultaneous confidence band for the cross-validation risks. So let sigma be the covariance of the Gaussian limiting Gaussian vector y. And we can just use standard plug-in estimate because we can just do it for every fold. And within every fold, we do the conditional covariance and then we average over the fold. And we take that, the diagonal of the estimated covariance, and then we standardize it, okay? So after standardization, so what we can do is, so what we can say is that, so for any M, so for all models in my candidate set, so the target risk, the quantity that we want to estimate lies within the confidence interval scaled at 1/√n, and the Z is the quantile of the Gaussian process, or the maximum of the Gaussian process. So this way we get a simultaneous confidence band for the cross-validation risk. All right, so this is straightforward. Like, this is essentially saying that with that Gaussian comparison, we can do this. And how does this help us, right? Like, I want to find the best model. Well, maybe you can argue that these confidence bands for the risks may be used for its own sake, but still I'm more interested in finding the best model or close to the best model. So that actually leads to the topic called model confidence set. Model confidence set is that we want to find out all candidate models that perform nearly the best. So there is actually quite a bit literature on this idea, like for the references I listed here. So the model confidence set is useful when model selection consistency is too hard to achieve. So if you have worked with genetics or GWAS, right, the SNPs are so highly correlated. So it's really, it's impossible for the standard model select, the variable selection consistency conditions to hold, because they require something like restricted eigenvalue condition or incompatible condition. So, and also the model confidence set allows the user to select the most reasonable, like if one models in my confidence set, although it's not the best performing per cross validation, but it's close enough, but it contains some variables that I think is really important predicting y. So I may choose to work with this model, right? And it also can be used to test hypotheses related to variable importance. Okay, so how am I going to use this high-dimensional Gaussian comparison for cross-validation to construct the model confidence set? So the first idea is really simple. So what I'm going to do is that I'm going to construct my model confidence set as all candidates whose confidence lower bound is less than all the other confidence upper bounds for the simultaneous bounds. Okay, so this is easiest to explain in this picture. So the curve in the middle is my actual value of that risk for each M, okay? But I don't have this true curve. Instead, I have an upper bound and a simultaneous lower bound. So I include all the models in my confidence set whose confidence lower bound is no larger than the smallest confidence upper bound. So you can manipulate the inequalities easily to prove that with the desired probability, the type one error, this set covers the best model. Okay, and you can of course argue this is too naive and it doesn't take into account the correlations between the different models, because it's very unlikely that for this model, the noise is upward, and for this model, the noise is downward. Usually the models, they should like be positively correlated. So the challenge is that how can we take into account of the correlations between the models and not to use this simple coordinate-wise simultaneous confidence bound. So, and the fix that I first came up with was using the differences, okay? So instead of just computing lower bounds and upper bounds for individual models, I directly look at their differences. So this approach, it works over each model. Like I fix an M and I want to test whether its risk is bigger than any other model, right? So if I'm able to like find one other case such that RM is bigger than RK, that means M is not the best model and I should reject it. Okay, so then here what I'm doing is for this particular model M, I consider the difference loss and the difference risk. So the difference loss is that like I fix M and I vary over K so that for every K, I subtract the loss of the model K from the model M. And then I will just count, then I have an M minus one dimensional Gaussian vector if my difference loss function still satisfies the two stability conditions, okay? Then all I need to do is to show that this M minus one mean vector, all I need to see is that the maximum, the entry-wise maximum crosses above zero. If that happens, then M is no good. If that doesn't happen, M is good. And this is illustrated from this picture. So for this one, because I'm doing M individually, on the left plot, I'm showing the case where M is in the confidence set. So here again, the solid curve is the curve plotting RM minus RK, the difference risk, plotted over K and fixing M, okay? And for this one, this curve goes a little bit above zero. That means M may not be the best, but it's close enough. And then our confidence lower bound that's what we can calculate from the data. Our confidence lower bound for this curve did not cross above the x-axis. So that means there's no strong evidence that saying M is not the best. So we just take the null hypothesis that M is perhaps the best, right, or close enough. And on the right plot is a case for M not in the confidence set. So the true difference risk curve goes above zero quite a bit. So that causes some point of the confidence lower bound for the difference risk to cross the x-axis. What this means is that because this is simultaneous confidence set, confidence lower bounds for the difference risk, that means for some k, we are confident that Rm is strictly bigger than Rk. So this way we should eliminate M because we know that M is no better than that particular K. Okay, so this way of constructing model confidence set is actually not new. Like I had the idea 5 years ago and the paper published a few years ago. But at that time, I wasn't able to say theoretically, like rigorously, how this confidence set will behave. And now with this V-fold cross-validation Gaussian comparison, now I finally am able to say something about this difference-based model confidence set. So all we needed is that if the pairwise difference loss function satisfy the stability conditions required in this subwibble sense, required for the high dimensional Gaussian comparison for cross validation, then the optimal model being covered in my confidence set. Oh, there is a typo here. I should write 1 minus alpha. Okay, so it's 1 minus alpha minus little o. My apologies. So here is a quick example showing the difference between the first method using the simultaneous entry-wise upper and the lower bound for the risk, and then the compared with the one based on the difference. So I'm doing the linear regression using the lasso, and I fixed the dimension, the ambient dimension, to be 1/10 of my sample size, and the sparsity is fixed at 5. So I choose my lambda, right? So then for the dashed curve is for the first method is naive method, then the solid curve is the difference based method. So the selected set size, the difference based method is much smaller. So it gives smaller confidence set. And it's also valid. And we can see that the naive method is very conservative. The coverage is 1, right? And we set the coverage as 95%. So the difference-based method is still conservative, especially when n is very large. So we do have some intuitions for this phenomenon. And so for n is large, it's more clear that there is one single best model, so that the difference-based loss functions is true. So the truth is far away from the boundary of the null and the alternative. So the 95% coverage happens only when we are close to the boundary, because now both the null and the alternatives they're composite. So when you are very deeply in the null, your coverage will be conservative. So here is a quick example of the diabetes data, where we compare all linear terms and the quadratic terms. And here is how the difference-based confidence set will perform. So it performed, like it selects 5 models, and the black one in the middle covers the one output by the ordinary cross validation. So I have maybe 20 minutes. So I will talk about the stability conditions. I think this is the most mysterious part, and also probably the least familiar part. Actually, it's the most challenging part in this paper too. So let's just look at the stability conditions. Now, like my notation is that my f hat sub I is the fitted regression function using the perturbed data, right? So the first order stability says that my perturbation in the loss function by using a perturbed f hat scaled by square root n divided by something small. I want that epsilon. That epsilon is my approximation error bound part of it. So epsilon l has to be vanishing. So to make the approximation good, I want epsilon to be small. So that meaning that this perturbation in the loss function is much smaller than 1 over square root n. And the second order is that, so it's difference. So that means with no perturbation, I put in my L and I subtract the two first order perturbations. One is perturbed at I, the other perturbed at J, and then I add back the both perturbations, right? So that's the difference. And I want that to be much smaller than n to the 3/2. Well, so these properties are non-trivial, and people have been studying them in the literature before. So in the CLT for cross-validation in low dimension, right, the author and the Joe, the original authors of that paper, proved the first and the second order stability for M estimators under strong convexity and smoothness. And then in the earlier literature in the machine learning community, Hard and the co-authors proved the first order stability for stochastic gradient descent. So second order stability wasn't a concern back then, but it becomes a concern if we want to prove Gaussian comparison for cross-validation. So now our new contribution, so we also would like to study, like, when would these stability hold? So I'm personally very interested in SGD because it takes into account the optimization error, not just the modeling error. So our new contribution is proving second order stability for stochastic gradient descent. And also remember, for the difference-based model selection, model confidence set to work, we need the first and the second order stability to hold for the different losses, And this is even more challenging. So I will describe these two in a little bit more detail. The first is stability of SGD. So suppose our fitted regression function is parameterized by theta, right? Theta could be high dimensional, right? Or low dimensional. So a popular way to estimate our parameter is through M estimation to minimize some objective function, right? So theta and the Zi, where Zi is my data pair Xi and Yi, right? So all the empirical risk minimizers are of this form, right? Like MLE, right? And then I denote like the dot psi be the partial derivative of the objective function in the optimization problem in the M estimation with respect to theta, the partial derivative, and the stochastic gradient descent, a very famous and widely used algorithm, just iteratively update my theta by moving a small step along the opposite direction of the current gradient. Okay, So alpha t is my step size. So here is what we can say about like the new type of first order stability of stochastic gradient descent. So if my objective function is convex and Lipschitz and its derivative is also Lipschitz, this is called beta smoothness, and the function psi is strongly convex. Then, and also if the step size, right, is diminishing, then what we can say is that the first order stability of our parameter estimate scales at n to the negative a. Okay, so if the loss function is Lipschitz in our parameter, then this implies our loss function enjoys the same order of stability. So for second order stability of stochastic gradient descent, we need another smoothness, and which is pushes further. That is the Hessian, the two dots, the Hessian of the objective function is Lipschitz. So this is natural. Imagine that you want to like control the residue of this second order Taylor expansion, and this is what you need there. So if this holds, then after maybe many pages of lengthy algebra, so we're able to show that this is a little bit worse, like with the logarithm term, than n to the negative 2a, where remember that t to the negative a is the step size. So the intuition here is, okay, the intuition is that the SGD update is contractive if we assume strong convexity. That means, so after one step of SGD update, the difference of the updated theta will decrease exponentially in its input. So that imagine that if we perturb only one point in our SGD, so if the perturbation happens very early on, so it has a large step size, so that's a large perturbation early on, but that difference will be shrunk in all the future steps. So eventually at time n, the difference will be very small. But if the perturbation shows up in that sequence very late, right, then it has a very small step size. So it's going to have a small impact anyway. So the intuition is more trickier for second order. So we don't have exact contractness. So we need to worry about a residual term along the way. Okay, so the next few minutes, I will talk about stability for the difference loss. So this is needed for the confidence model confidence set using the difference risk. So recall that instead of the original loss functions, we want to look at the difference loss functions. The problem is, so we can still do stability of this difference loss through the stability of the individual loss functions for individual models. But one crucial part of the whole proof breaks down, because before we required the functions that I'm averaging over fold has variance bounded away from zero, like lower bounded by a constant. But when I take the difference, this is no longer the case. Imagine that you have two fitted models using similar tuning parameters. So their predicted value will be very close, right? When you take difference, so that constant order variance term will get canceled when I take the difference. So usually you can expect, like in a lot of cases, the variance of the difference loss function actually vanishes. So instead of studying the first and the second order stability of the difference loss function itself, what I want is I want to study its order of magnitude after scaling, like by its own standard deviation, like the standard deviation of the difference loss function. So this makes controlling the stability much harder, because not only I want the nabla and the two nabla to be small, I want the nabla and the two nabla divided by some vanishing standard deviation term to still be small enough. So because we have to study the variance of the difference loss function, so the bias and the variance decomposition for model M and model K needs to be carefully tracked. So I wasn't able to do it in a general context, but instead I was able to show it because I need to track down the bias and the variance and their cancellation precisely. So I will work it out in a non-parametric regression example. So in this example, it's an infinite dimensional regression problem. The Y is a linear combination of X, the corresponding Xijs. So with parameter theta J. Okay. So I assume that the design and my noise, they are uncorrelated and the mean zero unit variance. So, and also assume a particular rate of decay of my true parameter theta sequence, because this way I know exactly how much bias is, like if I truncate my estimate at a particular point. So then for each J, I can estimate my theta J by the sample correlation between X and Y, because I'm assuming uncorrelated design matrix and an identity design matrix. So then what is my Fm and FK? They are simply truncated series estimate. So I just, for model M, I just keep the first capital JM terms and I regard all the theta entries after JM as zero. This is a truncate sequence estimator. And for JK, it's just a different position of truncation. So now my models corresponding to where I truncate my sequence of theta hat. Okay, so in this case, so I was able to show that if my design and my noise, they are sub-Gaussian, meaning that like if you just project them onto any direction, it satisfies the standard definition of sub-Gaussian. And then my JK and the JM, like they are not very close to each other, also not very far away from each other. Then what I can say is that the first order stability holds. That means after scaling by the standard deviation of the difference loss. So the first order stability holds if this JM times JK to the power of alpha over 2 is much smaller than N in terms of rate. And the second order stability condition can also be held if we put a stronger version on these JM and JK. So the main message from this result is that for stability conditions to hold, our models cannot be too complex. So like it's okay to have a little bit more bias, but too much variance will tend to break the stability condition. Okay, so I have a few further thoughts going from here. So the first is about the second order stability. Remember that in the low dimensional result, we only need the second order stability to be much smaller than m to the negative one. But now in our result, we needed it to be much smaller than n to the negative 3/2. So it would be sufficient if we can also assume the second order stability to be much smaller than 1/n, but we need to simultaneously control many of the small residues whose variance, like whose L2 or L3 norm is bounded by this quantity, but I need a simultaneous control for all these realized value from these residual terms. So that one way to do this is that assume that after standardization, meaning that dividing by their own standard deviation, they are one subwaveable. So I don't think this is a crazy assumption to make, because like I'm just saying after standardization, it has exponential tail, but it's hard to verify concretely. So that's what makes this type of assumption less appealing. Or maybe there's some other mathematical tools to better control the maximum of many small terms. So, and the second direction I would like to improve this method is the model's confidence set. So currently, even as we have seen in the numerical example, even the difference-based model confidence set can be conservative in some settings. So that seems to suggest that the L infinity norm-based Gaussian approximation is conservative when this is saying when we are far away from the boundary between the null and the alternative. The boundary is really like all models have the same quality, right? So how to make inference adaptive to the landscape of the risk curve, right? Like we may know that some of them are competitive, there's a small number of them are competitive and many of them are not, or many of them are competitive, that means the confidence set has to be large. So here I write BFF. So I mean, I tried very hard from a frequent test approach. So I'm thinking like I have heard suggestions from Bayesian saying that if you put in some prior, that may be able to help you. And I have even heard suggestion from Fiducial. So like my guess is keeping an open mind may be necessary to get the improvement. So the last thought is a potential application which me and my student are working on right now is fine mapping problem in GWAS. So fine mapping is the problem of finding the causal SNPs for some phenotype, and where the SNPs are highly correlated and the signal is very sparse. So it's impossible to pinpoint exactly which SNP is causal, but hopefully with combining this model confidence set with some greedy search scheme, we should be able to provide confidence sets of possible combinations of SNPs that can be jointly responsible for the phenotype. Mm-hmm. So that's what I have to talk for today, and thanks for your attention. I'm happy to take questions.
Great, yeah, thanks Jing for a great talk. So any question from the audience? All right, so I think I can ask you one about the GWAS one. But GWAS, how you validate those assumptions be valid for this kind of very noisy biology data?
Right, I think essentially the requirement is stability.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Right. So yeah, I have to admit that This is a very hard problem. And I remember last year I saw a paper, I think by Rina Barber, about estimating the stability of an algorithm. I think people have started to think about it, but my take is that empirically, like you do something similar to what Rina proposed in their work, but you do something like more practical, just you do a bunch of leave one out, see if the estimate is really stable. You can actually plot, right? Like mm-hmm. you just do many times of leave one out fit and see if the predictions remain stable. Just so in general, I think we have to guess it, right? To empirically verify the stability type of condition.
I see. Great. So like maybe on the original space, they may not hold, right? So, but if you are doing some projection using autoencoders, project it to some space in there, they may be easier to hold for this kind of stability condition.
Yeah, stability is really like a property about the algorithm.
Oh yeah,
right. And like even for SGD, so I can imagine that if I apply it to the GWAS data, right? Mm-hmm. So here the regularization has to come in. So to make the strong convexity the case.
Okay. So like when you do the GWAS, what kind of model are you doing? Like a non-parametric or linear?
I will try from linear, like the simpler methods, because the correlation is so high and the signal is must be sparse. So my first intuition is some greedy search plus the model confidence. Like I don't expect to really solve the problem, but like first I would like to see it working on some like between like toy model and the real data, like somewhere in between, like the intermediate simulation settings.
Yeah. So like you treat each SNP as one feature, right? Or you use
half? Yes.
Okay.
I think each SNP is a feature.
Oh, that's very high dimension. Okay.
That's cool.
Yeah. So is any audience have any question? If no, we will thank the speaker again. Thanks, Jing, for coming. A great talk. That's very
thank you.
Nice work. Yeah. All right. See you. So bye.
See you. Bye-bye.